Today we're going to be talking about some really cool stuff. As you know, I do a lot of reading and a lot of self-improvement. And the stuff that I'm going to be talking about today is basically, it's talking about habits. And one of my favorite things that I've been doing over the past few years is I try to eliminate negative habits and add positive habits. And it's really, you set your life on auto drive or autopilot when you create habits, because habits are just, you gotta have the discipline to create habits, but once habits are formed, you move on autopilot. So think about this, when you're driving to work, how many times have you gotten to work and you don't even remember how you got there? The reason for this is, you know, it's not that you're unsafe, you're still doing things, you're driving, but it's all been habitual and you've created these habits that allow you to do the same thing every day. And everybody does this, everybody creates these shortcuts so they don't have to think anymore. And it's really how we've succeeded in life. Now, so today, what we're going to talk about is this book. This is The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. This is one of the most popular business books around, and arguably one of the most influential books of the decade. There's over 25 million copies sold. So, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People is an excellent book, and so this is what we're going to be discussing today. So, one of the things that Stephen Covey mentions about this is that you need to be able to change everything about your life. And so he mentions, he calls this a paradigm shift. And so what is a paradigm? And this is something that I'm not sure exactly what paradigm means, but I'll try and describe this. And paradigm is essentially, you know, we tell ourselves the way that we believe the world is. And there's certain things that we have to, certain beliefs that we make that this is just the way the world is. This is the way things are. We accept things the way they are so that other things make more sense to us. And one of the ways to really see a paradigm shift or an idea or concept of where you expect your reality to be a certain way and we're shifting it to be a completely different way, a different belief system. You think about if you go out of the country and you go somewhere to a different place where it's, say, a third world country. You see how different things are, and you realize that it doesn't have to be that way. The way that we live in the United States, it's not this way around the world. So it's a different paradigm. People are living on a different belief system. And for me personally, I was experienced with this. I was able to go to Haiti after their 2010 earthquake, and we did some medical relief work there. We did some surgery. I did a lot of orthopedic surgery and amputations and things. And you can see some of these pictures on my website. It was an amazing experience, and I had the ability to help a lot of people. But from a paradigm standpoint, the shift that I experienced is that despite the poverty that they had in Haiti, these people were happy, or they seemed happy. You know, despite this destruction and devastation, the people were able to smile, were able to be hospitable, grateful, thankful. And you know, these are all things that a lot of people believe that, you know, they're going to be happier when they make a certain amount of money, or when they have a certain thing, or when they drive a certain car. They link their happiness to these materialistic items. And it's been shown over and over and over in studies that happiness is not linked to money. Now, there is a certain level of money that will get you more comfortable and perhaps have a certain level of happiness, but certainly these multimillionaires, these billionaires, are not substantially more happy than people with less money. So that was one of the things that I noticed. My paradigm shift is that I was focused on making money, and I thought that would make me happy. And I realized that it doesn't matter, you know, how much money you have. It doesn't matter what you have. It's really it's how you feel inside, and recognizing that and acknowledging that is what has helped me to change dramatically over these years. So now we talked about these 7 habits, and these are habits that you can use on a daily basis. And keep in mind, these are not fixes. These are not going to change your whole life overnight, but in time, if you continue to do these certain habits, they're gonna lead you into better things, and better things will seem to happen. And this bad luck that you seem to have, this life is happening to me, those things will be diminished. And so if you wanna be highly effective, highly productive in your life, these are the habits that you need to have. And you can start doing them one day at a time. This first one that we're gonna talk about is being proactive. And being proactive is something that it's really, you know, I read a lot of these different books, and it's talked about in a number of these different books, and it's not just about being proactive, but it's more about planning everything in your life. Everything that you do, you just need to think more about. And a lot of people, they struggle through their lives because life just happens to them. They happen to, their car breaks down, they happen to get sick, they happen to get pregnant, they happen to, you know, their house gets damaged, their roof gets a leak. All these things just happen to people, and they're stuck wondering, what am I gonna do? Oh my gosh, I have this extra expense. So being proactive, what does this mean in these situations? So what if you were able to plan? In the financial world, the suggestions are to have a 3 to 6 month rainy day fund. So what does that mean? It's having enough money to, if you didn't have no income at all, you had enough money in the bank in case you don't have any income and you need to survive. Say you get injured, you hurt your back, or you know, you want to have a rainy day fund in case your car breaks down, you need a new transmission. I think those are about $2,500 now. I mean, these big expenses, if you don't have a fund available, then you're gonna get caught and you're gonna get stuck in situations where you may not know what to do. You don't have the money to get yourself out of it. So you gotta be proactive and plan for when times are bad, because life isn't always good. Even for the best of the best, there are always gonna be down times. There's always gonna be times when bad things happen. So if you're not preparing for these times, you're gonna be caught by surprise, and it's gonna be a real problem. So be proactive. Plan your day. Plan your week, plan your year. You know, a lot of people, they don't plan any vacations, they don't plan any fun or anything to do in their life, and they end up not doing as many things because they're not planning. So take the time and plan. It's not that difficult. The next habit that I want to talk about is begin with the end in mind. And what does this mean? Now, you're going to see this a lot in athletes. Athletes do this visualization, and where they're focused on the end game, what they want to accomplish, their goal, they're focused on it, and they can actually visualize and see themselves doing it before it ever happens. And, you know, one of the things Stephen Covey says is that, you know, things happen twice, once in your mind and once in reality. So if you can take the time to be proactive and plan for these things, this is the way you want to think, with the end in mind first. And so you want to think of what your goal is, and then work your way backwards on how you're able to accomplish that goal. And some people call this reverse engineering of your problems. And so you can do this with all your problems. Say for example, I had my 6-year-old son the other day. He said he wants to be a professional soccer player, but he doesn't really practice, doesn't really do anything. He's not good at it. And so we're talking, and I said, well, how can you be better? What are the things that you can do to be the best? You know, let's think about this. If you're a professional athlete, what would you be doing? So if you're a professional athlete, you'd be practicing a lot. This would be a full-time job, 8 hours a day, 10 hours a day. You'd be working at improving your skills and doing exercises. You'd be in the best shape of your life. You certainly wouldn't be sitting on the couch watching TV. You certainly wouldn't be skipping out on exercises. You would be out there practicing. So think about the things that you need to do to accomplish the goals that you want. You want to buy real estate. If you want to buy real estate, there's certain things, you know, you have to have money. So you can either have your own money, or you can raise money from somewhere else. So think about your problems. Think about how to solve them by looking at the end game first, and how to sequentially the steps that lead up to that. So this is how you can break down and accomplish big ideas one step at a time. The next habit I wanted to talk about is putting the first things first, or the most important things first in your life. You know, we actually talked about this concept, and this was similar to if you listened to my last lecture on the book The One Thing. And this is the concept here is talking about prioritizing and putting the most important things first in your life. So people, if you're the type of person that says, I never have time for anything, you're always stressed, you know, you're always running around, feel like, you know, you're too busy for anything, and any new thing that comes up, there's so much anxiety that you don't want to do anything because you feel you're so busy. Now, these people tend to be those that they don't prioritize well. So they're doing a lot of things for a lot of different people, and they don't know how to say no. So these are the moms, for example, that they're doing everything for the kids. They don't know how to say no to their kids. If their kids want it, they're going to do it for them. And because of that, they feel like they don't have time for themselves. They don't feel like they have time to do anything else in their life. So they feel stressed and overwhelmed. So with this concept of saying is do the first things first. Let's take myself for example. What I do, what's important to me personally, is it's very important to me to work out. So I like to stay healthy and stay in shape. So I work out first thing in the morning. So I get that out of the way. Every single day I get it out of the way first thing in the morning, so then it's done. You get the important things done first, then you don't have to worry about the rest of the day. At least you know you were productive, you got your things out of the way first. Now if you're able to accomplish things later in the day, that's great as well. But you ever wonder how these millionaires, these billionaires, you see them on TV, they're walking around, it looks like they have nothing to do, they're just strolling around, they have all these people around them. They look like they have nothing to do because they did everything they needed to do already. And they took care of all their business before they even got out. You know, for me, if I can take care of all my business in the morning before I even get to work, I don't even have to think about work. I can just do the things that I want to do the things that I need to do. I can take care of my employees. I can train my employees. I can focus on them rather than on myself. And I can do that because I know that I already took care of the important things for me in the morning, and I've already taken care of my business. So first things first. The next habit I want to talk about is think win-win. And what this means is that, you know, in our society, we're all about competition, it seems like. You know, competitive nature within sports, within business, within school, for that matter. Everything seems to be competitive. And in a competitive nature, there's always a winner and a loser. And what Stephen Covey is saying is that you want to create situations where it's a win-win, where both teams are winning. So how do you create something like this? Well, look at a simple transaction when you purchase something at a store. So say I go into the grocery store and I want to buy milk. Well, for me, I don't have a cow. I don't want to, go milk a cow and get my own glass of milk. I'd rather just pay someone else to do it. So being able to pay it at a reasonable price, that makes me happy, to buy milk at a reasonable price. It makes them happy because they're able to sell it at what they believe is a reasonable price. So they're happy, they got money, I'm happy, I got my milk, both parties are happy, we go about our lives and everything works out great. Now, the only good transactions that happen in sales are when both parties are happy. So for liposuction, for example, we have our prices set, and people that get their procedures, they believe that it's worth it to them to spend that money to get their fat sucked out. You may be saying out there, that's crazy, I would never spend that money on liposuction, that's nuts, I would never do that. That's your opinion. But for someone else to feel like they're happy with it, I'm happy with accepting that amount of money, they're happy with spending that amount of money, they get out of it, what they get out of it is they get their fat removed and they get permanent results the rest of their life. So it's a win-win situation. Everybody's happy. Now, let's say, for example, we were charging too much. If our prices were too high, we'd have less people that were buying because they didn't feel comfortable with that. They weren't happy. They didn't feel like that was a reasonable price for our services. So that would be a win-lose. I would win if they paid it, but they would be unhappy. And if they were unhappy, they probably wouldn't speak highly of me. They probably wouldn't send referrals to me. So in the end, I would lose. So this is why win-win situations are a better situation, because you want everybody to win for the long term. And if they win in the short term and the long term, everybody's gonna be happy. Because if I make my customers happy, they're gonna come back to me in the future and be future business, which makes me happy. They're gonna send their friends because they're happy. That makes me happy. They're gonna send all their family to us. That makes us happy. That makes them happy. They're helping their friends. This is all a win-win situation, and that's what this is all about. So if you wanna be successful, think of creating win-win situations. You never, never create a situation where you win and someone else loses, because it's gonna be in the long run, you're not gonna get that business back. They're not gonna be friends with you. They're gonna be vindictive towards you. They're gonna wanna hurt you because they feel that they were slighted or they were taken advantage of. So always a win-win situation. The next habit I wanna talk about is seek first to understand, then to be understood. And so the concept behind this is that you gotta be able to understand what people are saying to you before you start speaking. Before you throw your opinions out there. And so how many times have we seen these people that they, while you're talking to them, you can see them thinking. They're shuffling around, they're moving their hands, they're moving side to side, and as soon as you get a short little break, they jump in there or they interrupt you. And the reality is these people weren't listening at all. They were in their head, they were thinking their whole time. They said this is what I'm gonna say, and they're plotting out their response, their rebuttal, their argument against whatever you were saying, but they didn't even hear a word you said. And so because of that, you're gonna get a lot of misunderstandings, and if you're this type of person, which I am, I was, I didn't listen well, and it affected my relationships. My wife, it was hard for us to communicate when every time she says something, I was just thinking of what I was gonna say next to her. I never actually heard what she was saying. So sorry, Corinne, if you're seeing this, but this happens with my kids too. My kids say stuff and I jump, snap at them and try and get them, try and say something that I want to say that I feel is important. When instead you should be listening to the person and really understand what they're saying. And from a business perspective, how I take this is with my customers, if I truly understand what they need, I can cater my services to better serve them and make them happier. But what if someone asks me for example, if someone says my most important thing is my midsection here, but I'm telling them, well, your arms are big and fat, your chin's big and fat, we need to take care of that. And they said, no, but my belly bothers me. I said, well, I think it'd be, your belly's not that big, let's take care of your arms. And basically trying to talk them out of what they want, and that's crazy. You got to listen to what they're saying. So I try to listen to everything that my customers are saying to better understand what their needs are, what their demands are, what their wants are. And if I can better understand that, then I can help them more and give them a better service, more valuable service. And ultimately it would be better for me as well as the customer. So seek first to understand before you want to be understood. Take your time to listen to people. There was one technique I read in another book. The guy suggested waiting 2 seconds before you speak. So when someone stops, pause for 2 seconds. And what this does, it actually gives them the ability, if they want to say something more, or they forgot to say something, it gives them the opportunity to say it. And it also gives you extra 2 seconds to think about what you want to say. So if you're listening throughout the whole time, you can have a better understanding. You got a few seconds to think about how you're going to respond and give an appropriate response. The next thing, the next habit is synergizing. So synergizing is something that it's really more about working with people. So there are going to be those loners out there, those people that believe that they do things better and they can other people don't do things well enough, so they don't like to work with them. But it's well documented that we can be more successful in doing things together with help. And you can see this is pretty obvious in a couple of situations. For example, I'm very busy with work and I spend a lot of hours working, and when I get home, I don't necessarily want to spend time doing work. And so there are things that I outsource that I'm not as good at. For example, we have someone clean the house. So this is something that myself or my wife would spend hours doing on a regular basis, cleaning, when we could have been spending time with our family, or we could have been doing other things that we value and we find more important. So with the help of someone else, we can be more productive. Obviously at work, with the help of my employees, I'm able to accomplish a huge amount more. Now, I could do a lot of things myself, but I have my limitations. I'm only one person. There's only so much that I can do in a given day. So with the help of others, we can accomplish tremendous things. So you have to understand that you will get better because of others. So focus on working well with others and creating that synergy. And what a synergy means is that you are more valuable or more productive with multiple people as you are by yourself. And you think of this like a piece of wood. One piece of wood, you may be able to punch through and break. Two pieces of wood together are substantially stronger than the two woods separate. So you may be able to break two pieces of wood separate, but you put them together and the synergy, the strength that the two combined is substantially stronger. And you'll see this in construction. They do this a lot where they put 2x4s together for support, and the combination of the two pieces of wood together gives substantially more strength. The last habit that we want to talk here is about sharpening the saw. And this refers to essentially the lifelong habit of learning. Now, as I said, many people, life just tends to happen to them and they don't really plan their lives. And what this is saying is that you need to continually be improving, because if you're not improving, someone else is. And if that someone else is improving ahead of you, they're gonna be taking your job, they're gonna be more qualified than you, they're gonna be a better worker than you, they're gonna be better at anything that you're considering doing. You know, you look at some of these kids nowadays, that their capabilities of working on the computers, working in internet and social media, they are all learning way more than I am about social media, because they're doing this stuff every single day. They're spending 8 hours a day on their phone and, you know, working with Facebook and Twitter. And, you know, I feel like I'm good at it. I've studied a lot. But if I don't stay on top of it, in a couple years, these kids are going to pass us right by, and it's going to be like second nature to them because they've done it so much. So you got to sharpen your saw. Keep getting better. And how do you get better? Going to conferences, reading, getting mentors. This is a big thing that people miss out on. Most people think that, you know, having a coach or a mentor when you're younger, that's what we do, right? Or you have it on a sports team, but most people don't have life coaches or mentors, people to guide them along the path. And so you want to find someone that's about 10 years ahead of you. In their career, in whatever it is that you're trying to do, that you can emulate. So you can ask them questions. How did you get to where you were? What are the things that you did? And these people can help cut years off your life. If you can avoid the mistakes that they've made and not make them, you'll be years ahead on the path here to success. So use mentors, find someone ahead of you that's already doing what you want to do, that's been doing it for 10 years and has had success, and do what they've done. So keep sharpening the saw. So in summary here, let's talk about the 7 habits and being proactive, plan your life, begin with the end in mind, start thinking and visualizing what's going to happen in the future so you can plan to be prepared. First things first. You want to make sure that you take care of the most important things first, so then you don't have to worry about that. Those worriers out there, this is important, because if you're always worrying about you have to do something, take care of it first. You don't have to worry about it anymore. Think win-win. Create situations where both party wins. It's the best situation. You'll be happy. Your company will be happy. Do this with your relationships as well. It always has to be a win-win. It always has to be a mutually beneficial situation. Seek first to understand, then to be understood. So listen better. Synergies. Work well with people. We can accomplish a lot more together. And sharpen your saw. Become a lifelong learner. All right, guys. This is the end of today's discussion. Thank you so much for listening. We're going to be doing this every week, where I'm going to be talking about a new book and trying to teach you some lessons here. This will hopefully get you guys motivated to live a better life and live the good life. So tune in next week, and we're also going to be doing another talk on Wednesday. So thank you very much, guys, and have a great day.